Hey everyone, it's May. Welcome to a special edition of the May Lee Show. This is another episode totally dedicated on the Lena Hernandez case. As most of you know, Lena Hernandez is the woman in Torrance, California, who assaulted three different Asian Americans with verbal racial assaults as well as physical assault. Now, this is a case that really blew up because some videos went viral. Two of the victims, the most recent victims, had recorded their encounters with Lena Hernandez in a park, and that just was explosive. And so this has become a much, much bigger story with a lot of focus, and I have been covering it and trying to get more information about what's been going on ever since. And as, again, many of you know, because I've been updating you guys, it's been a really interesting process because we have found out that the Torrance police made several missteps in this case originally from the first incident back in October, where they kind of dismissed it, claiming that the first victim had dropped the charges and retracted everything, which was not true. They also claimed that Lena Hernandez had fled the scene, so they didn't know who she was or wasn't able to get any information. Also untrue. So this has really turned into a story about how Asian Americans are not seen seriously in some ways and dealt with in a professional manner. And so therefore, the good news is, here are a couple of the updates. The three victims have all banded together. They have all come together to join forces, knowing that they have to push for answers. They want justice, all three of them. They're not letting this go. And the proof of that is that they hired an attorney just a few days back. And so now that they have legal representation, they're taking further action. One of the first actions they took was to put out this call for action. A formal statement that they wrote with the help of the attorney, Sandy Rojas, and they then put that out on social media, but they also, they sent official copies to city council members, the mayor of Torrance, Mayor Fury, the chief of police of Torrance, to be able to get this message out and to also make official what their demands are. Oh, they also sent it to the city attorney, Patrick Sullivan. So many of you may have not seen this call to action. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually read it. It's a little long, so bear with me, but I think it's best if I read it so that you know exactly what they're saying and what they're asking for and what this call to action is putting out there. All right. Today, we are united in our call for action, and we demand accountability from Patrick J. Fury, Mayor of the City of Torrance, Patrick Q. Sullivan, Torrance City Attorney, and Eve R. Berg, Chief of the Torrance Police Department. Hear us as we say we will not let Lena Hernandez's criminal acts of assault, battery, criminal threats, and child endangerment fueled by the hate of our status as Asian Americans go unnoticed. We demand that you not let these criminal acts of hate go unpunished. On October 11th, 2019, Kayceelyn Salminao, a Filipina-American Torrance resident, was physically assaulted by Lena Hernandez inside a restroom at the Del Almo Fashion Center. Lena Hernandez physically pushed Kayceelyn to the ground and yelled, "You better not get the F up or else." When Kayceelyn got up, Lena Hernandez grabbed her by the hair, pushed her head toward the ground, and punched her multiple times in the back of the head. This blatant attack was independently corroborated by an employee at the Del Almo Fashion Center, as well as Kayceelyn's husband. It is evident Lena Hernandez's actions were criminal. To date, there has been no justice, notwithstanding the fact that Kayceelyn has expressed to the Torrance Police Department that she was desirous of prosecution. These criminal acts of assault and battery were left uninvestigated, and Lena Hernandez has not had to answer for the crimes committed upon Kayceelyn. Even more unfortunate and misleading is the fact that the Torrance Police Department publicly stated on Instagram that Kayceelyn, quote, initially filed charges, but then decided to not follow through and retracted those charges, unquote. Kayceelyn has never retracted the charges. She has always wanted to follow through. She has remained consistent and steadfast in her desire for justice, and she remains desirous of prosecution. Most recently, on June 10th, 2020, Lena Hernandez physically and verbally assaulted yet another Filipino-American Torrance resident, Sherry Bolseco, while Sherry was working out at the Wilson Park. The verbal assault was captured on video. Sherry was within her right to work out at the park and was not interfering with Lena Hernandez's ability to travel down the stairs. Yet, Lena Hernandez went on a tirade, verbally assaulting Sherry and threatening her safety and well-being. In her racist rant, Lena Hernandez yelled at Sherry to, quote, go back to whatever effing Asian country you belong in, unquote. To be clear, the city of Torrance is Sherry's home. America is Sherry's home. Sherry belongs in this country. Sherry reported this incident to Torrance Police Department, and Lena Hernandez's actions were downplayed by responding officers. During the responding officer's investigation of the incident, Sherry expressed to the police that she felt threatened by Lena Hernandez's words and actions. It was clear she was a victim, but she instead felt like she was the one who was being investigated for wrongdoing. To date, Sherry's demand for justice continues to be ignored. A second incident occurred on the same day wherein Lena Hernandez can be seen in another viral video referring to a Japanese-American Torrance resident as, quote, Chinaman, multiple times, and mocking him in a derogatory Asian accent. The victim, who wishes to remain anonymous for the safety of his children, asked for respect from Lena Hernandez. In return, she retorted, quote, you are going to get effed and your kids are going to get effed. Lena Hernandez criminally threatened the victim and his two minor children. Lena Hernandez's actions not only victimized him, but endangered the emotional and mental state of his two minor age sons. The victim expressed to the Torrance Police Department that he was desirous of prosecution, but was later informed by the detective that the city attorney's office would likely not bring any criminal charges against Lena Hernandez. According to the press release by Torrance Police Department dated June 17, 2020, Torrance Police located and interviewed Lena Hernandez in a park in the city of San Pedro. However, to this day, Lena Hernandez remains at large. On numerous occasions, the Torrance Police Department diminished and decriminalized Lena Hernandez's acts of hate as, quote, unfortunate incidents. These are more than unfortunate incidents. These are, in fact, criminal acts fueled by hate and racism. We urge the Torrance Police Department and city attorney to pursue public safety and protect the victim's rights. Torrance Police Department has a duty to thoroughly investigate all crimes. The Torrance Police Department has failed in this regard, especially as it relates to Kayceelyn, for allowing her case to remain uninvestigated until the June 10th, 2020 incidents occurred. If Lena Hernandez had been held accountable for the October 11th, 2019 incident, her criminal behavior could have ended at that point. However, due to the Torrance Police Department's inaction, she was emboldened to victimize other Asian American residents of Torrance. Lena Hernandez's criminal acts have garnered worldwide attention to the city of Torrance, whose population is made up of approximately 37% Asian American residents. The Torrance city officials and law enforcement have a duty to protect all Torrance residents, regardless of race. Do not let these crimes go unaccounted for because of our status as people of color and Asian Americans. We demand justice for Kayceelyn Salminao. We demand justice for Sherry Bolseco. We demand justice for the Torrance resident and his sons. Justice delayed is justice denied. So that is the call for action that was put out a few days back with the help of the attorney that the three victims have hired, Sandy Rojas. And I was able to interview Sandy and get an exclusive interview with her about taking on this case, her thoughts on this case, and what they plan on doing and what our hopes are in terms of a result. So here is that interview that I did with her. Sandy, welcome to the show. Good to see you.
Hi, Maylee. Thanks for having me on your show.
Well, listen, I'm excited to talk to you because this is obviously represents a big step that the three victims are taking to have hired you for legal representation. So first of all, tell me how you were hired and why.
So, you know, I've been an attorney in the South Bay for over 15 years, and I'm really active in the community. And the victim initially contacted me a couple of days ago, or one of the victims, and had indicated to me that he was looking for some assistance for himself and the other victims because they were getting no support from the police department and no support from the city attorney's office. And that's how we started having this conversation. And I decided that I needed to be a part of this action and help the victims be heard with their calls for justice.
Right. So you obviously, just like so many of us, I mean, these videos and this story of Lena Hernandez has gone global. And so the attention was there. So you clearly were familiar with what had happened prior to getting the call, right, from one of the victims.
Absolutely. I actually shared one of the viral videos that I had seen on social media on my Facebook just a few days before I was reached out by the victim. And I was appalled with what was happening because this is my city, and I could not believe that this was in my backyard when, you know, Torrance is a very diverse community.
Right.
Asian Americans make up approximately 37% of the population. And that's, you know, over one third of the population that identifies with Asian American and Pacific Islander descent. So I was super shocked that this was happening.
Yeah, I think everyone was, especially like you're saying, it's 37% of the population is Asian American. So the fact that this was happening in that city, was shocking, but also shocking. And this is what I would love to know from you is once you started learning more about each case, right? There's three different victims. The first being Kayceelyn Salminao, who got assaulted at the Del Alamo Mall last October. When you started hearing about each case and the fact that nothing had been done, and in fact, some of it was dismissed and mishandled by the police at the beginning. Tell me what your thoughts were and what your then strategy became, because to me, as I started digging into the story, I was completely shocked by the fact that the ball was so badly dropped by authorities.
Right. I was completely shocked as well. You know, it was my understanding when I watched the press release prior to having any contact with the victims that the police authorities had indicated they were unable to identify the suspect at the time. But what I learned from the victims is that they already knew who the suspect was.
Right.
And they knew her because she was positively identified shortly after the incident at the Del Alamo Mall in October 2019. And that law enforcement sat on Kayceelyn's file and sat on her case despite her numerous attempts to get information, to get a copy of the police report, and to get some sort of movement on the case. They deflected her request. They ignored her request. And it wasn't until it took two more, you know, verbal attacks and physical attacks on Asian Americans for the police to take any further actions.
Yeah. And I know that one of the supervisors at the Torrance Police Department had told Casey recently over a phone call that it really was because of the global attention that this story was getting that they decided to take another look, which I'm going to say it. You don't have to say it. I was appalled when I heard that because I thought to myself, wow, so if this story hadn't gotten global attention, they would have just continued to ignore the fact that these three people had been on different levels assaulted by the same woman who was still at large. So that to me, from just a, you know, just from a legal perspective and also police, you know, investigative perspective is just, again, unbelievable.
It's absolutely unbelievable. And the most difficult part of this case is just knowing that Lena Hernandez is still there at large.
Right.
And that the statute of limitations for a misdemeanor assault will run in October of this year. So
for Casey's case, right?
Yes, for Kayceelyn's case. And had those other two victims not been assaulted and attacked by Lena, then Casey may not have ever received any type of further look like you had suggested.
Right, right. So again, as the attorney looking at this case now, trying to put together, you know, some sort of strategy, what are you looking at then in terms of where this stands? Because clearly these are different types of assaults, but we're being told, all of us, that they can't do anything. They can't arrest Lena Hernandez until the prosecutor makes a decision on whether or not to file charges and what those charges might be. So tell us in layman's terms what that means and what that how that affects your strategy.
Okay, so basically for a misdemeanor offense to rise to the level where the police officer can make an arrest, the police officer has to be present during that incident, which seems ridiculous, right?
Because it does.
So many instances will happen when there's no law enforcement present.
Well, most. So I mean, that's the thing. Most incidents happen without police in front of them. I mean, it's crazy.
Right. And I think it was premature for the police officers to categorize Lena Hernandez's conduct as a misdemeanor. Had they looked into the situation, had they looked at all her conduct as a whole, I think it rises, in my opinion, to a level of felony. And if it was at a level of felony, they could have made an arrest without being present. And that's where it's very problematic. And so the purpose of, you know, the call to action that we had the victims release is really to get their message across, to demand for justice, to demand that the Torrance Police Department and the city attorney's office look further into their cases so that they can get some justice and have an arrest made on Lena Hernandez.
Right, right. So right now, though, you're basically looking at misdemeanor charges, but not on a felony level. And also, sorry, go ahead.
No, that's absolutely right. So the city attorney has discretion to elevate the charges to a felony. And if the city attorney feels that these crimes should be charged as felonies, the city attorney would refer the case to the Los Angeles District Attorney's office.
Okay, I see. I see. So that's to be determined by the city prosecutor, Patrick Sullivan.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct, because the police department has already determined that these crimes should be categorized as misdemeanors.
Okay, but the prosecutor has the authority, if he sees something different, he could change it to a felony if he decides to.
Absolutely, and then he would refer the cases to the Los Angeles District Attorney's Office for prosecution.
Okay, okay. The other question I keep getting from a lot of folks, you know, and I mean, Sandy, so many people are interested in this case, and they're really up in arms about it, and they're demanding more information, and they're demanding justice, and rightly so. And I think this really has, you know, has been a catalyst for the Asian American community to start really speaking up about, you know, seeking justice and having their voices heard, which is why it makes me so happy that all three victims are willing to step it up. But one of the questions I often get, and I myself too have wondered, we saw those videos of what Lena Hernandez was doing to the recent victims, the two victims in the park. I mean, racially charged, really ugly rhetoric, right? I mean, there's no doubt about what she was saying to the two victims, right? Calling one of them Chinaman and telling the other one to go back to, you know, whatever effing country you came, whatever effing Asian country you came from. So this was all very racist, right, attacks. So a lot of people are wondering, well, this is a hate crime, isn't it?
In my opinion, it is. I believe it is a hate crime. It's her actions are made motivated by her hate for Asian Americans.
Right.
And in fact, when you look at all the victims together, okay, we'll start with victim number two, Sherry. She was assaulted by Lena Hernandez. And after being assaulted by Lena Hernandez, she was verbally attacked. And clearly, when you look at the pattern of the attack on Sherry and then the attack on the third male victim, it's motivated by racism and by her hate for Asian Americans.
Right.
And although Lena Hernandez did not make any racial slurs to the first victim, Casey, the fact that you look at the racist comments that she made towards the second and third victims, it's
It's a pattern.
Easily, yes. It's easily, you know, it is a pattern to show that she is someone that hates Asian Americans. Yeah. And I think with the criminal threats that she made, if you add those with the hate provisions that, you know, the hate speech that she's made, you can elevate these crimes to a felony.
Right, right. And I know that the third victim, the man who was with his two young children, that is a different level as well, right? Because she was making threats, verbal threats, against him and his children. And so that's a different level as well, isn't it? That's a very specific, potential specific charge.
Right. So that could, she could be charged for child endangerment, because basically what she is doing by threatening the children, she's endangering their social well-being, their mental well-being, and just it's just appalling for her to be doing that, not only to the male adult victim, but to the children in the car. And that in itself should, you know, warrant a filing of a child endangerment.
His kids are, I think one is 11 and the other one is younger, right?
Right. The other one is two.
Two and 11. Okay. So the 11-year-old obviously is old enough to know what happened and heard all of what she said. And you and I were talking on the phone yesterday in preparation for this interview. And I had said to you, listen, I know how those kinds of words can affect someone long-term, because I was a child who was always called names and a victim of racist, you know, slurs constantly. And I still remember that. It's very vivid to me. And I know that I carry that with me even as an adult. And so that is a serious offense. I do look at that as a very serious offense against those children.
Absolutely. And what message are we sending to children?
Yeah.
Are we sending the message that you can just attack someone for the color of their skin and get away with it and continue to just go on to the next victim? Right. So that's why this call for action is so important, because it's not only trying to protect the adult victims, but the child victim, so that he can grow up understanding that there are consequences for these type of actions.
Right, right. So you put out the call to action, which I read, and that clearly states what happened and what you're demanding. What else do you hope for in this case? Again, because you're representing all three and it is against one perpetrator, what is it that all of the victims are hoping for?
I think at the end of the day, it's justice one, and it's to unify the country, to have Asian Americans stand together and have society understand that, you know, we're not the typical complacent, quiet Asians. We're not going to allow this type of action to be, you know, unpunished, that just because culturally, we've been taught to respect elders, we've been taught to just, you know, let things go and be the bigger person, if that doesn't necessarily mean we cannot stand up for ourselves.
Right.
So I think this case, you know, uniting all the victims, uniting myself and our community, we can stand together and be strong for each other.
Right, right. Absolutely. And that's why I keep on pushing this story and trying to get more information and trying to empower our listeners and viewers. And, you know, Kayceelyn, in the beginning, she was a little reluctant, you know, to want to talk about this. And then once she did, she found her voice. And I joke with her now. I say, I think I've created a monster, but in a good way, you know, this activist monster. But I think it's great, because this is what needs to be done. Because again, I have said in previous videos, it's unfortunate that institutions that we're supposed to rely on and trust, we realize that oftentimes you can't fully rely on them. And you can't just sit back and think it's going to be taken care of. You actually have to become your own advocate if you want something done and if you want to be heard. And this is the perfect example, right? If this had been let go and no attention was paid, then the police, city council, mayor of Torrance, they would have been very happy to just move along, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And that's why we need the support of everyone in the community, Asian Americans, we need the Latina, Hispanic community, we need the Black community, we need everyone to stand by us so that we can be heard, because we cannot live in this type of society where we are being attacked because of the color of our skin, yeah. and the law enforcement is failing to take any action against the suspect.
Right.
The message that sends is
that it's okay. That right, it's okay that to it's do okay. that. You can get away with it, and it's normal. And it's not normal, and it's not okay. And the Asian community needs to say that loud and clear. By pushing back on something like this. So I really feel like Lena Hernandez, you know, what has happened with all of these three people and Lena Hernandez, it's almost become a symbol that represents the fact that Asian Americans are no longer going to sit by and say nothing and just take it, right? This Absolutely. Is the time for all of us to start pushing back. Let me ask you this, Sandy. I mean, you've obviously done criminal law. Is this something that you run into on a regular basis where authorities, how shall I say, choose not to take on a case or choose to try to, you know, sweep it under the rug? I mean, I just want to understand if this is typical or if this is atypical.
This is very typical. You know, I handle mostly family law cases, and I have a lot of victims of domestic violence. And when they make reports, law enforcement, many times their reports are they don't lead to a filing of a charge, and that's where they would have to file a domestic violence restraining order through the family court. Sometimes my clients and victims will tell me that there will be a violation of a court order, and they will make a report to the police authorities, and the police will not take them seriously or will belittle them or make them feel as though it was a waste of their time for filling out the report. Wow. And they often do get a lot of pushback. And this is especially the case with our victims is all three of them have not been given a copy of the police report. All three of them have not been afforded the opportunity to have a sit-down conversation with the city attorney or the mayor or further investigation with a detective.
Right.
So I think if the videos did not go viral, right. then they would just be brushed to the side, like yeah. maybe many other cases that we don't know about.
I mean, thank God for the videos. Thank God for those videos. Because I think to myself, wow, Casey's situation, she was actually physically assaulted. There was a witness, the custodian, who she was trying to help when Lena Hernandez was verbally attacking her first. And then, you know, Lena Hernandez was questioned, you know, after the incident. So she didn't flee the scene like the police claimed she did in the beginning. And even that, with all of that evidence, was ignored, right?
Right.
So again, if we didn't have these two videos, that case that had all the evidence in the world to me still would have been ignored. So it's pretty astounding. It really is astounding to me.
It's absolutely astounding and just unacceptable and intolerable because yeah. that Casey's case has very strong evidence. And for the case to just sit on someone's desk and not to be further looked at is unacceptable.
Well, and also the claim that the police said that she had decided to drop the case and retract her charges, which was totally untrue. So that was something that, you know, we were able to unveil later on once everything came up again. So there were a lot of missteps. And I'm going to be very frank about it. A lot of ineptitude that I have recognized as a journalist looking into the story. And so as an attorney, I'm sure as you're, you know, getting more information, it's probably maybe not shocking to you, but maybe you see this all the time, but it doesn't bode well for how how these situations have been handled thus far by the city of Torrance.
Right. So if there are any witnesses or any other victims of Lena Hernandez, yeah. you know, I hope they will reach out to me so that I can provide them with my services as well.
Yeah. What do you hope then? As an attorney working on this case, what would be your best case scenario, best case outcome?
So I think the best case outcome would be for the Torrance City Attorney to forward the case and refer it out to the Los Angeles District Attorney's Office for criminal filing of felony charges against Lena Hernandez on all three victims for assault, battery, criminal threats, and child endangerment.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So that would be best case. Obviously, we know what the worst case would be, that nothing will happen and this will be, get dismissed. But I got a feeling we started a movement here. I don't think people are going to rest until something happens and Lena Hernandez is brought to justice in some way. You know, again, I don't see anyone accepting this as, oh, well, you know, let's move on. All right. Let's hope not.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. One last thing. I know that the three victims, they're also organizing another park workout on July 11th.
Yes. Yeah, so we will be gathering peaceful park workout at the City of Torrance at the Wilson Park where the incident occurred for victims number 2 and 3. We're asking that all supporters come with dressed in black, wear, you know, bring some signs of support. We will be giving out free T-shirts to the first 100 guests, and the T-shirts are being sponsored by my law firm, Rojas Law, as well as another law firm, Black Belt Legal. We're hoping that this event will be meaningful for the Asian American community, and we're hoping that the call of action will be taken seriously and that charges will be filed prior to the July 11th event.
Okay. Okay. But that's great to hear that they're organizing another event, because I know the first one that sort of kind of happened right after the two incidents, people really showed up and wanted to show their support. So it was great that the community came together. And again, this is the beauty of something like this. It wasn't just the Asian community. It was white people, black, Latino. I mean, it was everyone coming together to show their support and show that they are against this kind of hate. So hopefully on July 11th, there'll be an even bigger turnout. And I know that there's also interest from some city officials who may turn up as well. So this is definitely making some noise. We're making noise and you know, getting the attention that this deserves for sure. So it's great that they have you, Sandy. I'm really glad you're a part of this, and I'm really glad that you're escalating it, because I think it needs to be escalated to the point of some action, right? And some resolution.
Right. Well, thank you so much for having me on the show.
Yeah. Well, we'll definitely stay in touch, because I think this is going to be going for a little while, but we're going to work on this all together to see what happens. But hopefully the result will be a positive one. And I think it will make a difference to all of us when we see justice. So Sandy, thank you so much, and we'll see you soon.
Okay. Thank you.
So I did that interview with Sandy yesterday, which is Tuesday. Today is Wednesday, July 1st. And I participated in a press conference this morning that involved Asian American activists talking about the growing racism across the nation. And then also Assemblyman Murasuchi of Torrance. He represents Torrance. And he specifically talked about Lena Hernandez and the incidents in Torrance. So I had a chance to ask the question about sort of the mishandling of these cases in Torrance by the Torrance Police Department, and also just the inaction thus far. So Assemblyman Murasuchi told us all that he had spoken to the city attorney just this week. And Patrick Sullivan had told him that he hopes to have some sort of decision made by the end of this week. Well, now, you know, we're running into July 4th weekend, and Friday it technically is the official holiday. So that means, you know, unless he comes out with something tomorrow, I'm not sure. But that is what the assemblyman said, that Patrick Sullivan had told him. So we'll see what his decision is about these charges. As you just heard Sandy saying, it really depends on what the city attorney decides on whether or not he is going to file charges, press charges, and what the level of those charges will be. Will they be misdemeanors, or will he elevate some of those charges to a felony? So we're going to wait and see what happens with that. Hopefully we will get that information. But I also want to say that during this press conference, when I posed the question about the inaction by the police and city officials, and is this a reflection of how authorities treat the Asian American community when we actually, you know, are making a claim or, you know, want to bring to light these kinds of assaults and hate crimes. Cynthia Choi, she's the co-executive director of Chinese for Affirmative Action. She actually had something really, really quite interesting to say. She said that, you know, there's an audit that shows that when reports that are hate crime related, when reports are made by Asian Americans, local law enforcement, they don't respond appropriately. According to this audit, they don't proactively work with the community. They fail to respond in reporting and following through on these claims made by Asian Americans. And she said that in this report, it seems to be a consistent pattern that there's a problem with properly tracking and categorizing hate crimes, particularly against Asian Americans. So I found that really fascinating. I'm going to get my hands on that report and take a further look, but that's what she had to say. So again, I think this is the situation in Torrance is maybe an example of exactly this. It's proving what this audit found out. All the more reason for our community to continue speaking up and pushing back and fighting for information and for justice. Because if we don't, advocate for ourselves, it will just be swept under the rug, unfortunately. The other tidbit that I wanted to share with you, and this I find also, kind of extraordinary. This apparently was posted on Nextdoor by a woman who, Nextdoor is the app, I don't know if you guys know, it's an app where you can join your neighborhood and you get different, you know, messages and information on your neighborhood, you know, everything from where to shop to criminal behavior, you know, all of the above, everything in between. So apparently this woman, this Asian woman who lives in Torrance, had written a letter to Mayor Pat Fury of Torrance. And it was a very heartfelt letter about how she's grown up in Torrance. She's built her life, her family, and she loves the city. She's been very happy in Torrance. But then because of COVID and all the negative rhetoric coming from President Trump and other, you know, sort of behavior from other leaders, it's changed. The mood has shifted. And so this was a very heartfelt letter about how she was concerned about what's happening in her city. And of course, the incidents involving the three victims she found to elevate her concern. So she was asking Mayor Fury to, you know, take this into account and take this seriously. She actually posted his response back. He actually wrote this in an email, and I just wanted to read part of it because, I mean, I found it shocking, his response. So he basically says, I'm sorry that this has happened and this is all happening, but he does say there is not much that can be done because the First Amendment allows most speech, including racist and hate comments. However, I remain an optimist that this will pass. That this will pass, as if it's just like a storm that's just going to pass. Then he went on to say, in the meantime, please know that the people who do hurt people with their words are, in my view, ignorant. But if their actions rise to the level of a crime, they will be prosecuted. Okay, that's good because that's law. But then he goes on to say, hopefully this societal phenomenon will end soon and we can get back to enjoying our differences. Societal phenomenon? This is not a societal phenomenon. Racism is not a societal phenomenon. Racism is a deep-rooted problem. Just ask the African American community right now that is, you know, raising the awareness about systemic racism that has existed for 400 years. So I'm a little No, not I'm a little. I'm a lot surprised by this response. Extremely disappointed that this is the way in which an elected official looks at this problem. So, again, I bring this up because you cannot rest on the idea that the institutions that we have in place are going to have your back completely and that everything will be taken care of. This is a time where I think awareness on all for all of us is increasing. Some of it is pretty ugly, what we're you know, learning, but this is necessary. It's painful, but it's necessary for us to all become better informed, better educated, and therefore more empowered to know what to do and to know that if you take action, if you're willing to take action, there can be a difference. Look at what the three victims in Torrance are doing. They have brought together their stories, their situations, their experiences, and they're taking action. And people are listening. And I really think it's going to make a difference. So just take a lesson and use this to empower yourselves. And we're going to keep on top of the story. Obviously, like we were saying in the interview with Sandy, on July 11th, they're going to hold this event at the park in Torrance as a show of unity and solidarity. Hopefully they will be able to, because of this COVID spiking, who knows what may happen, but hopefully we'll be able to go through with it using all safety precautions. Okay, so that is the update. Let's see if Patrick Sullivan, the city attorney, makes that decision and makes an announcement before the holiday weekend. We will keep on top of it. And of course, I'll keep updating you guys on what I know. All right. But again, thanks for all the support. And I know so many of you are wanting change. We can do it together. All right. Take care. Until next time.